Hello and welcome to the Bröhr Museum, here in the exhibition Andreas Feininger, New York in the 40s. We have a special guest today. It's Konrad Feininger, the nephew of Andreas Feininger and also the grandson of Lionel Feininger, the first Bauhaus Meister in history, also the son of Theodor Lux Feininger, also a painter. And when I got that right, you became an artist too. Yeah. Tell us a little bit about your career.
I have been an actor for 40 years, 35 of them in Washington, D.C., working on stage and recording audiobooks.
And you played many roles?
Like, sure.
Was there a character you played a lot? Kind of, is there a certain signature style?
I did a lot of Shakespeare.
Yeah.
Malvolio four times, Hamlet once, Macbeth once.
It's also an artist's career, of course. No?
Like, the best.
But not a painter. Yeah.
No, the best part was that I was in an artistic field, but not anything that came before. Mm-hmm. I watched my father compare himself to his father my whole life.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah. Okay. The occasion of your visit, of course, it's the exhibition New York in the 40s from your uncle Andreas Feininger. You never met your grandfather.
No, 2 years before
two years
me.
Before you, but can you tell us a little bit about your uncle? But because Andreas Feininger wasn't not only an extraordinary photographer, he did like almost 400 photo series for Life magazine. He also published 50 textbooks
yeah.
about photography.
Yeah.
He must be a workaholic. I think so.
He worked all the time. He designed his own summer house and he had a dark room mm-hmm. there, but he had a dark room in his apartment in New York. I only saw as a child. Mm-hmm. He was a very private man. His wife, Vissa, was much more outgoing than he was.
But she was always with him, I heard.
Not on his expeditions. But they were together all the time mm-hmm. in New York and so on. The family, I only saw Andreas 6 or 7 times in my life, mm-hmm. and 4 of those were when I was old enough to go by myself. Mm-hmm. He and my father lived 200 miles apart and didn't see each other for 30 years. They had beef.
Yeah.
With each other.
Okay. That's sad, yeah. But okay.
But it was perfectly normal too.
Yeah. It's like the best families, even in the Feiningers, yeah. So, but what brings us to the next question, it's probably the more difficult question, maybe not because for you it's normal, to be a Feininger. It's a very big name in Germany. Lionel Feininger at school already, at arts class. We talked about him and the Bauhaus, of course. Can you maybe summarize the meaning of being a Feininger, but in the U.S.?
In the U.S., it meant only that artistic activities were accepted and the norm. Okay. My older brother is a businessman, and that was not seen as good as being an artist.
Okay.
But America is such a big country that the name, nobody can say it. Feininger, Feininger, Funinger, Feininger.
It's the same Dreifachheit, yeah.
But here, of course, it's very different.
Yeah. So the name Feininger didn't come with any privileges in the U.S.?
Except in museums and at openings of shows and so on. Like.
Could you tell us then, because it's such an impressive artist family. Is there a certain secret behind defining his relation to art? Or is there, an attitude?
It's to follow your own path.
Yes.
Lux was a really good photographer in his teens, but then denied he was a photographer when he became a painter. And when he was painting at the Bauhaus, he was painting classical realism at a time when that wasn't really what was going on.
Yeah.
And Lionel was Lionel.
Yeah. Okay. So, the attitude is to choose your path and then follow. Kind of.
So, yeah.
Okay. So, and there are those famous images of your father and Andreas and your grandfather, where there was boats, the small boats there.
Mm-hmm.
Like, so I thought maybe there's a like this fable for technical questions or something like this. Is it?
That came back to Lionel. He did it as a boy. It was a big popular hobby in United States in the 19th century.
Mm-hmm.
In Central Park, there's a model boat pond. And he came back to life with it when he was stuck with Lux, had to drop out of school because of hay fever, and didn't know what to do with him.
Okay.
So he pulled these boats out of storage, and they started building new ones, and it turned into a big hobby again.
Yeah, cool. So. Lionel, Andreas, and Lux, they had to flee from Germany. Theodore left
He left earliest.
Then Lionel?
Andreas actually married Vissa and went off to Northern Europe.
Yeah,
I don't think he ever had to flee.
Lionel
stayed too long.
Oh, really?
He had a contract to teach in California in 36 in the summer and went back. They thought it was all going to blow over, no problem.
Mm-hmm.
Big problem.
Yeah. So then I'm interested because you just started, I don't know, when 2 years ago, you moved back to Germany.
Yeah.
I don't ask you why, but I'm asking you about the image.
That's why.
I knew that already.
Yeah, I know.
I moved
here for love.
Berlin too.
Yeah.
But the question, what image was it in your family you had from Germany?
It was difficult. Lux was fond of the German language and tried to teach it to us, my brothers and me.
Yeah.
But we made fun of it because it sounded funny and he gave up. But he had no desire to go to Germany until the lawsuit thing in the 80s.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the only thing that got him back.
I was pointing on the image of the Bauhaus, because the Bauhaus, the school was there like for, not long.
No.
1919 to 1930. 33 actually in Berlin the last episode.
Yeah.
But it became after World War II, actually in the 70s and the 80s, it just became the Bauhaus. It wasn't that famous till then.
Yeah.
What is interesting for me is like the image of the Bauhaus, was it seen as the liberal island in Nazi Germany, or was it kind of something they told you about this?
I think it was tough. For my father, being a teenager in the town, there were a lot of people not so happy with the Bauhaus, who they all thought were communists and so on forth. But everything was perfectly normal. You know, when my grandmother died, we inherited her furniture, which my father used in his summer house, and Marcel Breuer nesting tables. We sat on them to play chess every day. The furniture that Andreas designed for the master house kitchen ended up in the kitchen in a summer house and had to be protected from climbing cats. But what wasn't treated as a museum piece in any way.
Yeah. I think that's an interesting thing about design, that you still find an Eames chair on the street on the way. Doesn't happen with the Picasso today. Interesting. Okay, so. That was it from my side. Konrad Feininger, thank you very much for your visit. It was a pleasure to have you here.
Thank you for having us around this museum. It's beautiful.
Answering my questions. See you soon, I hope. Yeah?
Yes, we will be back.
And thank you for watching. And come to the Bruegel Museum. The exhibition is still running. And it's going to be extended also. So book a tour if you like. See you here. Bye.
Ciao.